are in a movie that's just been released by Inuyasha, the voice of Inuyasha, Richard Ian Cox.
I know him.
Oh yeah, yeah. So Richard Cox just directed us in a really fun feature, probably about 2 years ago that just got released recently. So it's called Last Night in Suburbia. But yeah. What have we got going on?
Oh,
DragonCon. All right, nice. I haven't been to a DragonCon yet, but I hear good things.
I'm Sharon.
Sharon, Michael.
It's Mr. David. I'm Owen, and I don't know him, but he's.
I'm Brian, and this is Dylan.
D-Y-L-A-N.
Yeah, I spell mine with a Y, too. That throws people off.
Oh, really?
B-R-Y-A-N. Yeah.
It's unique. I love it. So, do you guys have any questions for me, or what would you... This is a nice, intimate, interactive opportunity, so...
I got one. You play Colossus, right?
Not Colossus, but I actually play... I am one of the X-Men.
Right.
But I am Sunspot. I am Roberto da Costa.
Oh, wow.
So...
How was that like?
You know what? It's really cool. I have some unique, interesting connections to some pretty cool franchises. Relating to all of this, backtracking it here. What's the name of the? I want to say Moroku. Is that that character on Inuyasha?
Kirby
Moore.
You do him.
So yes. So. That character is played by a fellow by the name of Kirby Morrow, who is also Cyclops on X-Men, and also a dear friend of mine, and has been a groomsman at both of my weddings. So he's Goku and Moroku and Cyclops, and we also did a series together called Hamtaro, where I play Stan, and he plays my owner. I think his name is Noel in the show. But he and I actually live together with another young lady by the name of Yuka, who is now one of Stan Lee's personal assistants. So Kirby and I have had an opportunity to meet Stan a bunch of times, and in addition to playing Sunspot on the animated series, I have played the Incredible Hulk twice, but of course in parody versions. Once as the Inherited Hulk, somebody who believes they were once part of the Banner family, and the other one is the, there's the Inherited Hulk. I think the other one was the Implausible Hulk. But yes, so, nice. Yes. Anyways, so what's it like to be a part of the X-Men family? It was actually really cool. So, like I said, I've had the opportunity to meet Stan Lee a couple times because of my connection to...
Such great interview, such a nice guy.
Yeah, great guy. And because my connection with my former roommate and of course, working on both an Incredible Hulk and X-Men... project was kind of fun and cool. So, yeah, no, it was actually really cool to do X-Men. X-Men was a fun series that I think we all really dug and had it. And I always seem to get in these reinvented versions of things. So, with Once Upon a Time, we're reinventing or reintroducing is probably a better way to phrase it. Reintroducing some classic characters, and we did the same thing with X-Men Evolution because we're a little younger. So we did the younger version of that. So that's kind of fun. And I'm actually. Later this spring, I'm playing Dr. Watson in a Sherlock Holmes film that was written, the story was written by Stephen King. So it's myself and other cast members are from like Star Trek Next Generation, X-Files, a bunch of other shows like that.
Can you name those actors? Like which one?
I can tell you Denise Crosby
is
going to be in it. And the X-Files name I can't reveal, but I can tell you it's one of the actors from the X-Files is going to be in it. And
where's it going to be on?
Sorry?
What's it going to be on?
That I'm not sure, to be honest with you. This is a specific project that is connected through Stephen King has a series of short stories, and they're not that short because they're actually about an hour long. And in this particular case, this is called The Doctor's Case. This is the one time where Watson solves the case, not Sherlock Holmes. It's fun. I get to work with a fantastic actor named J.P. Winslow, who I've known for decades, and he's playing Watson. So it's going to be practicing my accent and all these sorts of fun things and getting ready to go. But yeah, no, through my acting career, I've had a chance to be a part of the Hello Kitty universe, Dragon Ball Z, X-Men, now Sherlock Holmes, Once Upon a Time. So.
Any other animation stuff coming up for you?
Other animation stuff. I hate when we have to say this. I just had to sign a non-disclosure, but for a very large anime that is epic to my own childhood, I have just auditioned to be the replacement or the new voice of an iconic character. So that's very recent.
Congratulations.
Thank you. So, yeah, so more news to come. Yes. But nothing to report yet. Nothing official.
Well, how has it been on shows like
Smallville, Eureka, yeah, so it's fun. You know what, I'm very appreciative of the opportunities I get. I get to work with a lot of really cool people. I just did a remake of technically it's a sequel. I did a sequel to an old Burt Reynolds movie this last fall, and I got to work with a fantastic human being named Lou Diamond Phillips, who's become a friend of mine, and we did a movie called Cop and a Half for Kids. It's Cop and a Half 2. But it's in the same spirit of that and Supernatural. The two lead fellas in that are even more handsome in real life. And blow your mind at the amount of handsome they are. So I feel really appreciative to get to have spent some time on that. Ironically, on the Supernatural episode I did, I came in and played one of the three little pigs. Played one of the three little pigs. And the very first shot of the episode says "Once Upon a Time," and it's this fairy tale episode of Supernatural, and I actually booked it before we did Once Upon a Time. So I've been playing fairy tales long before it was cool. So Supernatural was a lot of fun. I got to work on Smallville, which was really cool.
What season was that?
I did season 10.
Oh wow!
So I came in at the very end, and it was interesting because I actually have gotten to know some of the executive producers who have told me they wish that they knew that character was. I play a guy named Bert Camp, who has a serious man crush on Clark Kent, and I play like a forensics photographer, and I actually get to say I say an iconic line in the series, and it's just before the big reveal, and I get to tell Clark Kent, I'm like, you sir are a hero. You should put an S on your chest.
Remember that.
Yeah, so I get to do this really cool stuff. Which what's interesting about the role is he was always, I believe, intended to be straight. They never declared his sexual orientation in the breakdown, nor when I auditioned for the role. But Tom Welling, who plays Superman, my old writing partner is a fellow by the name of Eric Johnson, who played Whitney Ford, I believe his character was. He was like the bad guy in season one. Anyway, so I've got a lot of history. Kristen Crook, who's Lana, is a friend of mine. I knew a lot of the people, but I never had met Tom before. So I remember the first day of filming, we worked, and I was just, he was just like, it was hypnotic how handsome he was. And I remember we did the thing, and I got all up in his face, and I just got lost in his eyes.
And I was like pretty blue eyes.
Maybe. Oh, he's just gorgeous. So, you know, I remember getting lost in Superman's eyes, and then I was like, oh, this character's gay. He has to be gay. So I was just like, I was like, I'm just going to play it like I'm madly in love, to the point where the first take, Tom was like, what are you doing? I'll tell you what, I'll play it differently if you stop being so handsome. And we had a good laugh, and we played it out, and it was so much fun, and we had a great time with that, and you get to save me, and all these sorts of fun things, so it's been cool to work on a lot of shows. I did a show called Fringe.
Did you work with John Noble?
I didn't, which is unfortunate, because he's a lovely man. We have lots of mutual friends, and I hear nothing but wonderful things.
What about Leonard Nimoy? Did you get to interact with him at all?
No, nothing with Leonard Nimoy. On the Star Trek front, so I'm working with Denise in this upcoming series, and William Shatner is a big fan of Once Upon a Time. Yeah, so I chat with Bill quite a bit on Twitter because he's always giving us a hard time during the episode about what the heck's going on here, Happy.
He loves his Twitter too.
Yeah, I was like, Shatner, I don't write the show. Like, I gotta do whatever they tell me to do. So he's great, he's fantastic. But on Fringe, I got to work with Josh Jackson, which is fun because I'm an old school Mighty Ducks fan, so that was pretty cool to work with Charlie Conway.
That one.
What's that?
What was your role in that
one? On Fringe, I came in and did a guest star on an episode where it was called Marionette, and it was an episode about a young lady who dies and donates all her body parts to science, and then a crazy man, played by one of the actors from Schindler's List, who's epic to work with him, but he actually goes back and takes all her parts back and rebuilds her. So I had
like
her
Frankenstein
eyes.
Frankenstein kind of stuff?
Something like that, yeah. So I had her eyes, and he ripped my eyes out of my head and gave it back to the young lady who donated them to me after her death. And he recreated her Frankenstein.
And that was called,
eyes.
What was that one called?
Marionette.
Marionette.
Yeah, so that was a really fun episode to do. It was really cool. It was pretty creepy, as some of the Fringe stuff could be. So yeah, that was pretty cool. So yeah, Supernatural, Smallville. I did an episode of... one of my favorite episodes of television ever. I worked on a series called StarGate Atlantis.
Oh, wow.
And I did an episode with Bill Nye, the science guy.
That's the one where the guy, the scientist, and Jill Strait go to the symposium.
That's correct.
And Neil Tyson deGrasse.
Yeah, Neil Tyson deGrasse. So, I mean, and I'm an old school Kids in the Hall fan. Like, they're Canadian legends where I'm from. I do sketch comedy. Dave Foley and all the boys had a group called Kids in the Hall, and they still tour on occasion. But yeah, so I remember I was on set with Bill Nye, the science guy, Dave Foley, Jewel State was there. Who else did we have? Dave Hewlett was there. Neil deGrasse Tyson was there. It was just great. Like, it was just
gonna be awesome.
It was just such a nerd fest.
Yeah.
In such a great way. Like, it was just all my favorite nerds all time, and myself, a self-proclaimed nerd. Like, to have lunch with those guys was just legendary. It's one of... We only did one day on set together, but...
You get to go on the set with the gate and the gate room and all that?
Not on that episode, but a lot of the people involved with the series are friends of mine personally, so
right.
I've been on the set, but...
How is it like when you see, like, the gate room and SG-1, how... That one was so blinged out. You had the blue lights and all
yeah,
that.
Yeah. And I never saw the one on Atlantis, though, so I never got to see that.
You got to see the one SG-1. Which one did you see? Which gate room did you see?
That I can't recall, because to be honest with you, that was so long that it was such a long-running series. And I did work on that series, but again, I came in late. I came in...
Vancouver, they filmed it.
Yep, that's right. Yeah, I came in season 9 for Stargate SG-1. And then Smallville, I remember when I got sized up for that, I did go get to see, like, his little fortress of isolation. So I snuck around. When I went to go through for my wardrobe fitting, I ran around.
They have that suit in there that was in the glass. Have they prepped that yet for the coming out of the thing?
They hadn't yet, or if they had, I hadn't seen
right.
it. Because I gave myself an unofficial studio tour against everybody else's best recommendations. But when you get a chance to go snoop through Superman's personal items, you just do.
That's right.
Interesting dynamic, to be honest with you. I mean, the Seven Dwarfs have been there since season 1, episode 1, so we've been fortunately, we've been a nice constant for the series, and we've been invited to come in and do some comic relief, I think, for the most part, and, you know, in season 1, we got to kick a little butt, and then mostly after that, we've been for laughs, but it's been fun. I would say, you know, on that show, what I really... It's interesting because, you know, I've just met Jafar for the first time ever. We never had an opportunity to work together on the show, but I've made lots of friends that are really good friends, like a guy who plays King Arthur I consider a real good friend, but he came in for a short stint, and Peter Pan, yeah, he's a good buddy. Some of my best friends in the world are Robin Hood and Captain Hook and Evil Queen.
Good friends to have.
Wicked Witch, yeah, which is weird. You know, it's not lost to me, but it's nice. You know, it's really Georgina Haig who came in, and Elizabeth who came in and played our Anna and Elsa. I'm so grateful that we got a chance to meet them. I remember it was Georgina's birthday, and she plays Elsa, and my daughter, I guess, would have been 3 at the time. Huge Frozen fan, and the first daddy-daughter date we ever had to go see a movie was to go see Frozen. So I still have great memories of I'm at the beach with Elsa on her birthday, she sang Let It Go to my 3-year-old daughter, which is just, you know, just heart melting. Yeah, so it's interesting. It's we've had a lot of people come and go through that show. Giancarlo Esposito, who, you know, many of us know through Breaking Bad, amongst other things, Jungle Book, but to have him come in and be the magic engineer. He's one of the sweetest human beings you'll ever meet. Same with Bobby Carlyle, you know, one of the nicest human beings you'll ever meet. You know, he's a Bond villain, Trainspotting, legendary, everything. And to get a chance, one of the things I've liked about such a large ensemble is I've been introduced to so many incredible, cool people. Barbara Hershey is one of the nicest people I've ever met on the planet. And like I said, you know, Josh Dallas, Ginny Goodwin, lots of really, really sweet people. Lee Ehrenberg, who plays Grumpy, he'll probably be one of my best friends till the end of my days. So what's nice about such a big ensemble is my friend base has expanded exponentially. One of the challenges is that it's really hard to get into everybody's backstory. So creatively speaking, it's always been interesting. And I don't envy the creators or writers for the epic challenge they've had in doing that. But I think they've done a really good job on it. You know, I'm not sure anybody will find more passionate fans anywhere in the world than Once Upon a Time. And they take their storylines pretty seriously. And I think that's indicative to how these stories resonate with all of us. I mean, I think it's really unique that it's part of all of our backstories, you know. I don't think any of us really remember when we started knowing these stories. We've just known them since birth.
Right.
And the fact that they've got everybody so impassioned for this series, I think is a huge testament to their abilities. So it's been fascinating. It's been an honor to be a part of it. There's not an actor in the world who would say they want less language or less dialogue or less scenes. So everybody always wants more.
Is that a problem, you know, trying to get more screen time?
It's never a problem, because I think one of the key things to remember as a professional actor is your job is to serve the story. And in all honesty, like, this is Adam and Eddie's story. And I think the fact that they've invited me to be a part of it in any way, shape, or form is not an honor that's lost on me. So I feel incredibly privileged to have that. And there's also two sides to every coin. So on one hand, you know, if somebody asks me how much dialogue do you want, well, I want all of it. How many scenes do you want to be in? All of them. But at the same time, not if it's at the expense of my friends who are insanely talented. Like Lana Perea, I think with what she's done with the Evil Queen, it's an epic legendary character that we'll remember for the rest of our days. You know, Captain Hook, I think, you know, I grew up with more of the cartoony version. What Colin has done with that character, I think, is just, it's breathtaking. It's beautiful
amazing.
Work. Ginny and Josh with Charming and Snow, and my buddies who all play the other dwarves with me. Rebecca Mader, I love her as the Wicked Witch. She truthfully is one of my favorite human beings on the planet, and what she's done with that iconic role, that, you know, it's a challenge to take something that everybody knows so well and to make it your own. But it's interesting, she's the Wicked Witch to me. Lana's the Evil Queen. Like, and I grew up with different versions of it myself. To see such good friends do such amazing work, it's really cool. So, yes, you know, I'd like parallel universes to exist where we all get to have all the dialogue all the time. But at the end of the day, I'm also thrilled and honored to just simply play my part and do what I can. I've also been really lucky. They've given me lots of fun stuff to do. And I go back to, you know, the early days of season one where we stormed the castle. And, you know, I got to shoot a flaming crossbow. And I got to kill a bunch of knights with my swords and my axes and all these sorts of fun stuff. So I go back to that. And at the same time, they've given me lots of fun dialogue where I get to say funny things and piss off Snow White. And the amount of time, I feel like since season one, everything I say to Snow White, it's always so combative, which is weird because I love Ginny Goodwin in real life. But, you know, that being said, she broke my mug. Her daughter broke my axe. The power got cut out in one season and I couldn't watch TV for a while. So there's lots of reasons to get mad at those ladies. But anyways, it's a lot of fun. It's really cool.
Well, I know we've been talking about your live action work, but what's voice acting like in comparison?
Voice acting is infinitely different. Infinitely different. So I've had a chance to voice a couple of video games. I've played played a bunch of pirates on a series called Far Cry.
Oh.
I did a series called Gundam, Gundam video game. And on that, I played a character on a show called Gundam Seed Destiny. Inuyasha, Hamtaro, Hello Kitty. Play a lot of small furballs, which is fun. I have a friend named Amber Benson who was a character on Buffy Vampire Slayer. Anyway, we did a movie together, and she just calls me furballs or something. Because that's what I'm playing, is a bunch of furballs in animation. Same time, though, you know, I've got to be, you know, one of the X-Men. So I got to be a superhero, which was really cool. I got to audition...
Several superheroes.
Yeah, so I've got a chance to do some really cool stuff. I did a really cool project called A Tree of Palm. If anybody's into anime, you should look up a movie called A Tree of Palm. The artwork is just magnificent. The story's beautiful. Like, it's one of these a little bit more off the radar kind of thing. It's more of a, if you're into something like Spirited Away,
yeah,
be something more along those lines. But A Tree of Palm, it's a beautiful movie I got to be a part of. So in the world of anime, you know, it's interesting. Like, I when I first got started, that's how I made my living. While all my other actor friends were waiters, I did this Japanese cartoon stuff that nobody had heard of. And we revoiced them, and I did shows like... I started out on a show called Dragon Ball Z, and then shortly thereafter did a show called Hamtaro. Actually, I did a couple episodes of something called Card Captors and Ronda One Half.
I know that anime. Yeah. I watch that every Friday.
Do you really?
Yeah, he still keeps up with
Yu Yu Hakusho.
Really?
Sometimes I like to imagine it kind of being a crossover between Kid Icarus Uprising and The Legend of Zelda.
Yeah.
He's done his research.
I love it. Oh, that's brilliant. So, yeah. I mean, it's interesting. Like, I also did a show called Infinite Revias, and I'm trying to think what else I was on. Oh, there's so many. Young Keith Black. Oh, Dragon Drive, Project Arms. But it's interesting when you do animation, like specifically anime. I would often go in and do 4 episodes at a time.
Oh,
and,
wow.
And I would do like 4 episodes in 2 hours, which those 4 episodes air over the course of 2 hours. So, but you would only go in and just say your lines. So, well, back then, you know, we'd use this the language of OJ, which is the original Japanese. So, you could either choose to hear the OJ or not. And often, it's not a bad idea too, just so you get an idea what's happening in the story. That being said, you're trying not to copy somebody else's work, so you don't want to hear it to make it original. But you would just go in and just record all your lines. Okay, that episode's done, and you wouldn't necessarily even know what's happening. But in there, we have, not only did they script the language, but they would script your reactions or your feelings. So it's like, you know, depending on the show, like on Dragon Ball Z, I'd say half my dialogue was, gets punched, throws a punch, gets punched, yells for a very long period of time. So there's a lot of things.
Who did you play in Dragon Ball Z?
I played a character named Idasa. I came in, it was one of the earliest things I did. It's a tournament called, part of the world tournament thing. I fight Trunks. So I come in and I play a bully and I make a joke about him making a poop in his diaper. He starts things and then he proceeds to kick my butt all over the place. So, which I actually had originally auditioned for the role of Trunks. Long before playing Idasa, so.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. So no, it's fun, you know? It's interesting to get, I'm a character actor, so I usually get brought in to do something kooky and weird, and to try to do something fun, and try to add a little levity to things. I've actually just recently, I'm one of those overnight successes that's taken 20, 30 years to get there.
formula.
It really is. You know, it's funny now, because, I've had a chance to work on some pretty cool franchises and play some pretty fun roles and do some cool things. And now I'm just starting, I'm playing a lead in a TV show and 2 different movies that are all being released in the summer. So, like, I've got a bunch of stuff that's going to be more Michael Coleman centric coming out. At the same time, what's really great is I've spent so much time in the trenches doing the character work on these bigger franchises. I have an appreciation for it. So I have no desire to outgrow any level of acting. Like, I'm happy to come in for a day, or happy to be number one on the call sheet, and I'm just happy to tell good stories. I'm at that point in my life, so. Yeah, I'm excited to play Dr. Watson in a Sherlock Holmes film, especially, you know, something penned by Stephen King. That's kind of a boyhood fantasy. I think I'm the only actor in the show that hasn't worked on a Stephen King project yet. Like, everybody else has done a movie or a TV series that they've been associated with. So, and there's a lot of pressure, because this is the doctor's case, so this is sort of the one that I have to take the lead on, but yeah.
How's that going to differ from, is that more of a darker take, I guess, since it's Stephen King, I mean, somewhere else?
You know what's interesting? It's actually, it's less dark than you would think. What I like about it, I know style, style-wise, we're shooting it very traditional. So I know, like, you know, in recent years, we've seen things with the Benedict version.
Right.
Yeah, and then we've also seen Robert Downey Jr. had one that was a little bit more modernized.
It was good.
Yeah, so we're going to lean more towards the Benedict style in terms of being a little bit more authentic to the era as opposed to any CG or anything like that.
Young Sherlock Holmes.
What's that?
Yeah, the Young Sherlock
Holmes. The Young Sherlock Holmes, for sure. And that's the thing, like, there's, you know, if you go through it, what's interesting about it is the amount of information on researching a character like this is overwhelming.
Did you have to read the books? I mean, I'm sure you didn't read
every, and you never have to, and it's more of a, just different actors put different elements into their research.
Right.
So for me, I choose to. So I choose to do a lot of reading. I choose to do a lot of viewing and a lot of research in terms of finding out what can I do to make it unique for me in this particular version. So hopefully everybody likes it. I think we're having a lot of fun with
when
it.
Does
so
that, when does that start?
We go to camera in 6 weeks.
A lot
of pressure. It's good though. It's good. So, and then and at the same time, I'm shooting Once Upon a Time, doing some pickups for that film we shot last summer, and then shooting a pilot for the other TV series. So I got a lot of stuff on the go over the next 8 to 10.
The
pilot's for a show called Hipsterverse. And I star in a show about sort of this cross-generational. It's probably more reflective of an old series called All in the Family.
Oh, wow.
Okay.
In terms of being a social political soundboard.
Hipster All in the Family, okay.
Yeah, so this is, you know, I play a character that's not always politically correct, but he's got a huge heart. He's trying to figure out how to talk to millennials and baby boomers and represent Gen X all at the same time. So. We did a web series version of it that's actually on air right now through Dish TV. We did, I think, 8 episodes of a web series, and now we're going to go into a full half-hour situation.
That's coming up.
Sorry?
It's coming up.
That one, we're shooting the pilot. The 8 episodes right now are on something called Tag Channel down here or
okay.
Dish TV down here. So you can find Hipsterverse on TV as we speak, but we're... evolving it for the next level, so it's going to be a busy spring summer for me. And then I'm doing another 10 or 12 of these conventions for Once Upon a Time. So we're doing some Once Upon a Time specific stuff coming up.
What's some of your upcoming adventure going to be?
I do the official creation tour, so that's like the ABC tour for Once Upon a Time.
Star Trek events and all that.
That's right, Star Trek, Supernatural, Vampire Diaries. So
oh, some great events.
Yeah, so Gil McKinney, he plays Prince Eric on our show, The Little Mermaids fella. He also did some Supernatural, so he does a bunch of them. A bunch of these things. So got a bunch of, and then the film that I did last summer, I actually wrote and directed it as well as starred in it. So I'll be doing festivals around the world for that. Hopefully go to Berlin and a couple places down here and all over.
What's the plot of that one?
That movie's called 3017, and the idea is I play Adam Pye. I'm a software billionaire genius, sort of a Bill Gates type, and I have everything in the universe except for positive memories from high school. So I go to my 20-year reunion and have such a great time that I offer everybody in my grad class 1 year salary to come back and do one more month of high school.
Oh, wow.
So that I had positive memories of high school.
Who created that?
That was mine.
Now you
created
that. Wow.
I created that. So it's fun. I got a bunch of friends from I got some famous friends now, and they're all lending their talents to this film. So I got friends from like Battlestar Galactica and a bunch of other big name shows that are all come in. And so it's a big ensemble piece. There's 18 of us in the grad
class.
That's
called again. That's called what's that one called?
It's called 3017.
3017.
Yeah. So we're just looks pretty good. Like it's in the same spirit of like a Stranger Things, which is such a great homage to the 80s. This film is unapologetically an homage to John Hughes and classic high school movies of the 80s and 90s. So there's a lot of things where it's going to be a little on the nose and some really fun stuff that, you know, anybody who's old enough to remember something like Ferris Bueller or even Top Gun or anything like that, there's lots in there for you. And I think it's really fun.
So you're playing like an 80s billionaire tech guy.
Yeah.
Kind of like an early, like a software or hardware? Or
software. I'm kind of like probably more like a Steve Jobs than any.
Okay.
Yeah, so that's really what I am. Like, if Steve Jobs had a bad high school experience and went to a swing reunion, and said, how about if I gave everybody a year's salary to go back to high school? That's basically what this movie was. So.
That sounds cool.
Yeah, I think it's lots of fun. So I'm super stoked. Actually, creatively, one of the guys I literally went to high school with personally co-directed the film with me. He's a director. He does primarily horror, but we're two guys who stayed with it. So it was kind of fun for us to go back and make a high school movie with a buddy that I actually literally
went to.
Where
are you filming that?
We filmed that up in Vancouver. So the guy I co-directed with, his girlfriend was my locker partner in high school. So it's gonna be fun. It's been fun. We got a couple things that we're shooting when we go back. So a couple more scenes, a couple pickup scenes, but it's gonna be great. So that's a little bit about me. Does anybody else have any other questions about?
Who did you have a? Do you ever have a crush on somebody when you're voice acting? You know, like, did you ever have a crush on that chick who played Gagome?
That's a great question. Okay. Do I ever have a crush? You know what? Yes, I have lots of crushes in cartoons and real life. I get lots of crushes. In the world of anime, I'm trying to think who some of my earlier crushes were. There's an actress named Monica Riel who played Hello Kitty. I had a big crush on Monica when I first met her, and it was fun played this little puppy dog ninja named Inu Noshin in Hello Kitty. So I had a big crush on her when we were together. I've had a crush on almost every show. Jewel States, she's pretty cute. I remember her from Firefly, so working with her on StarGate was pretty fun. And we had the same convention agent, so we haven't worked together yet, but probably save her if we don't. I got too big of a crush. Save her for everybody.
I have a side question. You don't do any like charity stuff by chance or anything like that?
I do loads of charity.
What kind of stuff do you do?
I myself have navigated a couple of near-death experiences. I had a very severe case of something called ulcerative colitis from an early age, and then I had a bit of a malfunction with my large intestine. So all my guts are gone. I don't have any guts. And then a year ago, I got diagnosed with something called Guillain-Barré syndrome, which is a lot like ALS or MS. So I actually had to relearn to walk and talk. As I'm speaking to you now, the left side of my face is actually still paralyzed from the disease, so I'm still trying to regrow. But in addition to that, I've been a big part of different foundations for ALS, and cancer, and anti-bullying, mental health. BC Children's Hospital is a children's hospital where I'm from, and when I was a kid with the ulcerative colitis, I used to live there. So I've been sick a lot, and then I've had lots of friends and family who have been sick, and so I've attached myself to quite a few different charities that, right now I'm working a lot with a charity called Bullies Keep Out. So I'm doing a lot of stuff with that. I try to be as helpful as I can. I just recently, I'm a big Vancouver Canucks fan, which is our NHL team where I'm from. So as a Canadian, you have to like hockey or take the other country. So I actually have been working a lot with the Vancouver Canucks alumni. So I've been playing hockey with my boyhood idols, and we raise money for something called the Downtown Eastside Women's Shelter, which is for women and children that for various reasons need different kinds of support. So yeah, I'd probably spend a good chunk of my year working through charitable organizations and things like that. And, I think it's important that we all do. I think we all can, so we all should. So yeah, any reason for that question?
I deal with some charity myself.
Yeah, okay, yeah.
We'll talk about that later if you want.
Sure, yeah, no, for sure.
You seem like you're doing a lot of stuff, so you're going
to do that. Anytime I can lend my voice or my efforts to something that puts a little positivity back in the world, I'm a big fan of, trying to leave this place in better condition than when I got here. So whatever I can do.
Positive future, right?
What's that?
Got to envision a positive future, right?
Yes, absolutely. And I got two young girls that, I got a 5.5-year-old and an 18-month-year-old daughter. So I'd be lying to you if I told you I thought about anything else every day than how do I make sure when I go it's a better place for them. Mm-hmm. And that's maybe selfish, but that's really what at the end of the day, it's a selfless reward to do something for these people. So I adore them and my wife. So yeah, they're good people. Any other questions from you guys?
Yeah,
And I don't have a watch. We seem pretty unmonitored, so I'm not sure even what time it is.
We have about 20
minutes. Oh, good. Okay, so we got some time. Does anybody else have any other questions?
So most of the time when you do the voices, the other actors and actresses aren't there?
It depends. So there's two different ways that we, well, there's actually lots of different ways we do it. Primarily, we do something called prelay or ADR. ADR is automated dialogue replacement, and that's like the Japanese cartoons where we replace them. But we don't just do that for Japanese. We do it for lots, and that's a single person. You're what's called an ISO booth. You watch the cartoon and you voice it back. Similar would be like if you remember the old Robin Williams, Mrs. Doubtfire,
oh,
and when he did that thing with the, I think it was a parrot.
Right,
that,
yeah.
That's very much what it looks like when we do ADR series. Now, when you do prelay series, that's generally we're all circled around a bunch of microphones that are in the middle, and everybody stands around them and we let our voice. I've done a few of those. I played, I don't know if you remember the Olsen twins from Full House. I played one of their boyfriends in a cartoon once. And then I've done a few other things. Action Man was a series I did.
Oh, Magic.
Yeah, so there's a few different shows I've done in the prelay style. My most of my work, however, has been done in ADR, dialogue replacement. We did some fun stuff for some German TV where it's actually more like karaoke, and there's this giant band where the words come across and everybody's dialogue comes across, but you have to you're row 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6, and as the words go through the line in the center, you say them. It's not a very organic way to do it, but that is an old school way that we've done it as well. That's not really ADR or prelay. But prelay is fun because you get to hang out with your friends. It takes a little longer though because there's a lot of joking around and stuff. Where in the anime stuff or anything you do ADR, like you could do, I can do 4 episodes in 2 hours. Just go and say all my words and get the heck out of there. So there's benefits to both. I like both for different reasons. Prelay pays a whole lot more than ADR. That being said, ADR's got all the anime and all the fun stuff, and I got more action figures from ADR. So I got more toys out of the ADR than I do out of the prelay, but can't always be about the toys. But it's usually about the toys.
So how did you get an acting job?
That's a good question. I think part of it is, like when I was, in all honesty, when I was younger, and because I was sick a lot, I had to use comedy as a means to deflect a lot of the awkwardness or bullying I would have received being ill. So I gravitated more towards the drama kids and the drama ideas. And then I think part of it is that I just refused to grow up. So like I'm still at an age where I don't want to decide what I want to do when I grow up. I want to just keep having fun every day. And then another part, you know what, that's probably a good answer for when I was in my 20s, but then I really became fascinated with the idea of being a professional artist and being a professional storyteller. And it seems sometimes silly for a professional television actor to call himself an artist, and I know sometimes that sounds facetious. But truthfully, I'm in love with the idea of art, and to me, we have art as a means to educate and or entertain. So for me to say that's how I spend every day is educating or entertaining, I think is a noble effort. I think it's a really cool thing. And art has always been how our moment in time sees yesterday, today, and tomorrow. I like that I get to be that representative for our moment in time or a piece of it. So I've grown more and more fascinated with it. You know, it's an addictive thing, this professional art. The more you know, the more you realize how little you know and how much you crave knowing the next things. I've been really fortunate to work with an acting teacher named Larry Moss on numerous occasions. And in addition to teaching me about the craft of acting, he's worked with, you know, up-and-comers like Leonardo DiCaprio and Hilary Swank and Jim Carrey and all these sorts of, you know, legends. So it's kind of fun sharing the same acting coach. And it just makes me more and more appreciative of it. To be an actor is, you know, we don't lie for a living. We don't tell lies. What we do is we behave truthfully under imaginary circumstances, which requires an incredible in-depth level of self-awareness and evaluation. And I think, you know, what a lot of people pay a lot of money for to get therapy or self-assessment or any of these sorts of things, that's what I do all day, every day. Like, I feel incredibly fortunate that my whole day is to how are you feeling and why? And I'm like, it's kind of neat, that's your job. So, pay $100 and hundreds of dollars an hour for somebody to ask you the same questions I do for fun. So, that's kind of cool. Is there anybody that you think I should have a crush on in the world of anime? Who am I missing?
Katie Griffin.
Okay. Katie Griffin?
Yeah.
Yeah? All right. I'll make sure I make a note of that. I fall in love easy, so I'll have to make sure that I'll remember that one. And you know what? There's some really cool people. Really, really cool people in this business. I mean, the neat thing about being a professional artist is because you deal with a bunch of people who just have feelings all the time for money, you end up meeting some really, really cool people. And it's pretty hard not to fall in love with everybody you work with, so. Male and female alike, which is great. It's really cool. Yeah, do I steal stuff from set? All the time. Cool. All the time. I get in trouble for it all the time.
What's the coolest thing you ever stolen? I'm just curious.
Coolest thing I've ever stolen. No, I steal something all the time. My favorite thing that I've ever stolen, I'm so cautious to say it because we're being videotaped, but I'll say it anyway. No, it's all right. I get in trouble sometimes for stealing my nose and my ears on Once Upon a Time.
Nice, man.
Technically speaking, we're not supposed to.
Right.
But technically speaking, they throw them in the garbage can.
Well, Nemo has ears.
Yeah, so I took my nose and my ears, and I may or may not have a couple copies of my nose or ears at night back in my studio. One of my favorite things, I did a movie about movie about J.K. Rowling, and I play the Gringot. And ironically, the same people who did my makeup and special effects for the Gringot are the same team that work on my face for Once Upon a Time. And they made a full head cast and arms for me so they could create these really cool Gringot arms and head. And I remember I took the head and I took the arms, like the mold, because they're actually my hands and my head.
Jeez.
I just took them and they're like, I don't think you're allowed to take those. And I was like, I think they want me to have these. And then I just kept walking. And then because I had that already, I actually still have my Gringot head that I can wear as an actual living mask and one of the hands. And I only have one of the hands because we ran out of money and couldn't make two of the hands. So if you ever watch the movie, it's called Magic Beyond Words, and I play a Gringot in a story about J.K. Rowling. And in the entire movie, my character does a lot of this. And the reason I do a lot of this is we only had enough money to make one hand.
That's crazy. That's crazy.
So that's probably my favorite, but I've got something from everything. Smallville, Supernatural, everything, Fringe. I'm totally gonna get fired. You can't fire me, the show's not on anymore. But yeah, so I've got lots of cool, fun stuff. I usually take something personal, and I usually ask props, hey, is anybody gonna miss this?
Right.
So
they throw a lot of stuff away.
They do. Like on Fringe, for example, like they rip my eyes out, so I have a scene where I'm in the hospital, and I got my medical bracelet and things like that. So I took my medical bracelet, cop and a half, I took my cop badge. What else was there? Can't remember what I took from Supernatural, you know, Once Upon a Time. Smallville, I have some of my CSI, different things I had in the role as the forensics expert. So I have some of my forensics stuff.
Yeah, like a whole museum in this.
Oh, I do, actually. My office got some cool stuff. In the world of anime, I usually just buy my action figures or something. So I got some cool, fun stuff from like Hello Kitty and Hamtaro. I don't have anything from Dragon Ball Z, though.
Oh, man.
I need to get the Dragon Ball Z thing.
They made action figures.
What's that?
Did they make one of them?
They did not make an action figure.
Oh, wow.
But now you can get action figures
custom
made.
Yeah,
I might actually custom make one of an action figure. I should, because I'd really like... He's such a cool guy. Like, he was fun. He was a fun character to play. So, yeah. I should, you know what? Now I feel like I'm gonna go make action figures for all my guys. Like, if they didn't make an action figure, I'm gonna go get it made because I think that actually be really cool.
Who makes? Is it, you know, a particular person that makes those?
I just know they make them all over the place on the internet. So I might have to contact somebody and say, "Hey, I need to make like 30 action figures."
How did you break into voice acting?
You know, what's funny. My roommate was Kirby Morrow. Was Goku on a show called Dragon Ball Z, and for my birthday, he bought me a studio time to go make a voiceover demo. So that was just a birthday present. It was really just more for fun, and he's like, "Hey, you want to make a demo?" I'm like, "Eh, I'm kind of a kind of going to be a movie star. I don't really want to do cartoons. It's like, okay, movie star, before you do cartoons, before you become a movie star, why don't you do some cartoons for fun? Because some of us, that's how we pay the rent. So I was like, okay. It turned out really cool. It's super fun, and I love it. I love it. So, and I've got to, like I said, I got to do some really cool stuff and get some cool toys out of it. And my daughters have seen some of my work. And one of my favorite shows I did was a show called Hamtaro.
Right.
I don't know if you guys got that down here, but
yeah.
Hamtaro was a show where it's the first time anybody paid me to sing on television. So that was kind of fun. And I still, like, my daughter goes to school with a Hamtaro backpack and a Hamtaro lunch kit. So we got some fun stuff right there.
Who again did you play on Hamtaro?
I play Stan, so I'm Sandy's twin brother.
Okay.
So I'm the sexy Hamster.
Okay.
Which is also cool, because I don't get to play sexy very often, which surprises me. So I play, I play the sexy Hamster.
I'll have to go back and watch that one for you.
Yeah, it's fun, it's fun. It was a fun show. That was me getting the, your time's almost up. Does anybody else have any other questions for me? All right, well, you guys around all weekend?
Yes.
All right, well, I'll be over there. I'm signing some autographs. We're taking some pictures. And I think they got me coming in here. So if you come back in here and I tell the same war story, you can call me out on it. And feel free to ask me on some new stuff, too.
We enjoy hearing your stories, man.
What's that?
We enjoy hearing your stories.
Absolutely.
All right, well, thank you so much, you guys. Really appreciate it. Thank you. Very kind of you. Thank you.